Hi everyone, my name is Rahul. I work for IDP India. Today I have the pleasure of hosting two of my wonderful colleagues from IDP Connect team in Canada. My first panelist today is Ms. Christine Wok. Welcome, Christine.
Thank you so much, Rahul.
And my second panelist today is Ms. Luna Das, and they both are from Canada, and they are here to speak to me about all the burning issues that our students are facing today.
Thanks, Rahul. It's nice to be here.
So, welcome both of you. My first question is to you, Christine. What we are hearing from students is that, with every intake, students are finding it very, very challenging to get admission in their desirable institutions. They're saying that there is a lot of competition. A large number of students are applying for limited seats at institutions. Mm-hmm. So are you also hearing the same from institutions back home in Canada?
Absolutely. I think at the end, as we're coming out of the pandemic, there's huge demand and loads of deferrals. So all of the institutions we work with across Ontario, across the whole country, are experiencing the same problems, and I think really eager to move things a bit more quickly than they're currently moving, but it's a common problem and I think everyone's experiencing it right now.
And we also keep hearing about PPP, public-private partnership.
Yeah.
So is that helping institutions expand their physical presence in Canada as well?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. So that's allowed colleges like Niagara and TSUM, Fanshawe, ILAC to really expand the physical space they have, because that's one of the constraints, is that there's no, this creates extra room and extra space in downtown Toronto for students to come. So it's created thousands more seats for students. So I think that's exciting, and we're going to see that continue. And so I think there's a lot of hope, and that's why we've created these.
What do you think, Luna?
I just maybe add one point to what Christine said. I think this would also provide an opportunity for students to think beyond GTA and think beyond downtown Vancouver schools.
Yeah.
So this would provide an opportunity for students to sort of look at places where they were not originally looking at, because those places have capacities even now.
Yeah. So beyond Toronto, Montreal, and Vancouver, I think is important. We have schools across the prairies and on the East Coast, smaller communities in Ontario, Northern Ontario, British Columbia. There are seats in Canada. So I think it's to think outside the box is important right now. Like, apply early, and we can get into that too. But there are seats, but I think you have to be a bit more open and do your homework of like what's available beyond the obvious or the biggest cities, right?
So Luna, a lot of times students, decide which institution they want to study in because they hear about those institutions from their friends and families and people who are already there in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So what is your advice to such students? I mean, how should students choose an institution and a program for that matter?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think as human beings, we always like to sort of take advice from our friends. But I think what we really need to understand is that you have to do your own homework at the end of the day, and it has to be driven by the program that you're interested in, something that you would enjoy working, the areas that you would enjoy working in, and doing your research on the labor market.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's not necessary that if your friend has gone to X school, you need to necessarily go there, because I think your Canadian experience is also about meeting new people,
right,
putting yourself into situations
yeah.
which are difficult. So I would say that look at the landscape as a whole and focus your priorities based off your program, what are the job opportunities that you can sort of find in that particular field, and also focus on embracing the culture, because your networking skills are going to get you your internships, your jobs. So so that's where I would advise the students to focus their energies on.
Perfect. Christine, what about the quality of education? Is it consistent throughout Canada? Because we hear that a lot from students that, there are job opportunities in bigger cities, so I want to go there. The quality of education is much better in bigger cities. So how much truth is there in that?
Yeah, I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't agree with that. So I think that the quality of the Canadian education system is standardized. So if you're a college or you're a university in Canada, you meet a standard sort of level of curriculum. And in fact, sometimes in smaller communities, there's huge job opportunities, right? In Northern Alberta, there's very small colleges and universities, but huge job opportunities from the moment you land. And then post-graduation, great co-op opportunities. So I think that's maybe a little bit of a myth, maybe an urban myth, that the big cities have all the quality. I think that if you're willing to go slightly outside, say Toronto into Southwestern Ontario, Northern Ontario, Niagara region, you go out west, go into the prairies, lots of opportunity. And sometimes it's better to be a bigger fish in a smaller pond, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, just adding on to what Christine said, one of the main issues that we are finding is housing. Again, yeah. Bigger cities, it's a huge issue. If you go to smaller places, the community there welcomes international students because they know that they're going to be contributors to their economy. Also, some colleges for certain programs which are not, again, in MTV cities, as Christine was mentioning, offer guaranteed internships. Mm-hmm. And, you know, internships can lead into jobs and permanent opportunities. So, yeah, so I think those are the things that a student needs to really keep in mind. Look at the holistic picture again. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And look at the labor market in those other smaller communities outside of Vancouver, Northern British Columbia, etc.
So basically what I'm hearing is that students should look at alternate options beyond the larger cities that they've heard of. Mm-hmm. They should take their own decisions depending mm-hmm. on what is the best fit in terms of the best program, best institution mm-hmm. for them. And that will help them fight some of the competitive issues that they're facing right now. Because if a large number of students apply to limited number of institutions in bigger cities, then of course everybody will face problems.
And Rahul, to your point, the competition doesn't stop here. Competition also goes into the job market.
So, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Why be at a place where, as Christine, you were mentioning, a small fish in a big pond and compete for the same jobs? Be there where you're needed more than... Mm-hmm.
And that's true for all of the supports, like your co-op job, your internship, your post-grad job, right? Better quality of life, potentially better housing, if you're not competing for this small little pool with so many people.
So my second question to both of you is that, you know, another thing that we are hearing from students is that mm-hmm. they're facing huge delays in the visa application. So some of our students have applied, like, you know, 2.5-3 months in advance, and they're yet to hear back from the IRCC. You know, if you check the IRCC's website, you will see that the average visa turnaround time is way beyond the promised turnaround time, especially under STS category. Mm-hmm. So, you know, students are stuck. We just talked about competition, that, you know, it is so competitive to get admission in Canadian institutions. After facing all that challenge, when students apply for visa, there are huge delays. So what would be your advice to all our students? How should they navigate or be prepared to navigate around these tough circumstances around Canada?
Mm-hmm. Well, the first thing is, as you said, there are huge delays and you have to apply early. So you have to apply well in advance. I think if you're normally, you're applying to a few different institutions, but as soon as you get that first offer from an institution, initiate your visa application immediately. Don't wait. There's no guarantee that you're going to get another offer from another school. I would initiate that because of the delays.
Yeah.
Would you add anything to that, Lena?
I would just say that in general, your timeline has to be preponed by many, many months. Mm-hmm. So for example, if a student is really looking at the fall of 2023, I mean, you have to start the process a year in advance. So your research might have to be done a few months earlier to that, so that you're ready with, you know, done and dusted with everything within that 1 year, so that you can mm-hmm. apply for a visa as soon as you're eligible to apply. Mm-hmm. So it's a game of thinking early, planning early, and, you know, executing your plan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so typically students, especially for colleges, students mm-hmm. would typically start like 6 months in advance or 7 months in advance, because it was always considered that, you know, the application turnaround time for colleges was much shorter than university.
Right.
So for university, students have been applying 11-12 months in advance. Yeah. So are you saying that students for colleges should also start doing the same?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think with the in the times that we are living in right now, where the demand, there's a huge gap between demand versus supply, I think we should be moving towards a timeline mm-hmm. which is 12 months minimum, or maybe even earlier if the student has everything set and done. Maybe they can really look at starting the process even earlier than that.
Great.
Yeah.
And Christine, you touched upon, you know, students waiting for multiple offers.
Yeah.
Because, you know, usually, typically students apply for 2, 3, 4 institutions, sometimes more.
Yeah.
And, you know, even if they get an offer or a couple of offers from 2 different institutions, mm-hmm. they keep on waiting for, you know, the most desirable institution.
Yeah, yeah, before they even start them.
Yeah. So you touched upon that. So would you like to expand on that?
I just think I would echo what we said. This is what Luna said. This is a very competitive time. So this is not like, you know, a couple of years ago where maybe students had a bit more time and a bit more luxury. I think there's really huge demand, and we don't have the capacity to, and there's so many delays with these visa processing times, that I wouldn't continue to do that. Again, I'd be very strategic and surgical about this. Do your research, apply early, fine, apply to a few institutions, but as soon as you get that offer, I think you have to initiate the process.
Yeah, fully agree with you, Christine. It's not the time to pick and choose anymore. No. Just do your
I think you have to be competitive. Yeah. Sorry.
Absolutely. Yeah. No problems. Yeah.
So, okay, so, you know, what I'm hearing is, what I understand after all this discussion is that, you know, students should be very, very strategic. Mm-hmm. They should choose the institutions where they really want to study. Once they get an offer, you know, they should accept that offer without waiting for an alternate offer from a different institution. And then try to apply for visa as quickly as possible, maybe like 4, 5, 6 months in advance, if that helps them. Yeah, so I think students should take a lot of value out of this discussion. And we also talked about, you know, students for universities, they used to apply 11, 12 months in advance. Currently, college students, irrespective of the institution that they're applying to, should also apply as quickly as possible, maybe 11, 12 months in advance. So students, in summary, no matter what kind of institution, no matter which institution in Canada you're applying to, please apply for your admissions at least 11 to 12 months in advance. As soon as you get an offer, please accept the offer, because offers are precious right now. Do not wait for an alternate offer from a different institution, because as we have talked about quality of education being consistent across Canada. So no matter which institution, which offer you accept, you are going to get quality education. And then initiate the visa application process as quickly as possible, at least 4, 5, 6 months in advance. That will help your case. So Christine and Luna, we talked about visa delays and how students are stuck. So we do have a category of students currently who have applied for visa and who are still waiting to hear back from the IRC. So what are the options for these students?
Yeah, well, there's, you know, given the pandemic, there's schools are dealing with a lot of deferrals right now with the delays. I think the good news is that we all just found out that IRCC extended the ability for students to start studying at home, online, and still for the next year, actually. So that's great news. And then that still allows you to be qualified for that post-grad work permit. I think it's key, if you get a visa, if you have your acceptance, you have a visa, start studying now from home. There's no need to wait, because I think this deferral process is just going to continue. So I think that's key. It was good news, it was last minute, so not everyone wasn't really prepared for it. But I just say, yeah, get started at home if you can.
Okay. Well, as Christine mentioned, not everybody is offering online classes, so what can these students do?
Yeah, Rahul, you're right. Every institution very clearly puts in if it's an online, blended, or an offline program. So I think that's the first thing that students really need to keep in mind. The other thing is, obviously, this announcement came in late, so institutions did not really have the time to react immediately to it. And then I'd say that the moment you get your visa, if you really want a deferral, then just apply for deferrals and adhere to the dates. The other thing that you can do is also, you know, talk to the program advisor, because if there are, let's say you don't have a program where you really need to start doing labs from day one, I think there might just be an opportunity that you could start your program. So in summary, I would say keeping the deadlines, understanding what you could do when, and just communicating with your IDP counselor becomes very, very important here. And as Christine mentioned, if you can start the program, if there is an option to start the program from home, just start the program and wait for the next intake where you could join the in-person classes.
Excellent points. So students, check with your IDP counselors. Find out if your institutions are offering online classes or not. If they are, and if you're still waiting for your visa, please start your classes online. As soon as you get your visa, you'll be able to fly to Canada to attend physically. If your institutions are not offering online classes, then find out what is the deferral process. And please adhere to all the timelines, all the deadlines related to deferrals, and apply for deferral as quickly as possible so that you at least get a guaranteed seat in the next available intake. My next question to both of you is, what are the pain points that institutions have at their front? So how can our students and our counselors make life easier for institutions?
Well, thanks, great question, Rahul. I'd say two parts to it. One is sending an absolutely completed application packet, because that will help the institution assess the application at one go rather than waiting for things to come in bits and pieces, and that delays everything. Again, you know, it's connected to the theme of delays. The other thing is preparation, you know, how well prepared you are, because oftentimes students feel that they are not able to really pay for their education when they land in Canada. So just understanding what finances are involved, as much research as they can do, maybe doing the paperwork before the process starts, like, you know, what entails eligibility for an education loan, those kind of things. And, you know, Christine earlier mentioned about which cities are you really looking at, or should you be looking at, if you've really decided on a few cities, should you just be looking at that? Are they a good fit to you, or should you be looking at expanding your horizon and maybe looking at places which might be a good fitment? So I'd say that using that time for a good fitment.
Yeah, absolutely. I think connected to research, like, so you want your expectations to match reality when you arrive.
Yeah.
So if you're going to a smaller city and a smaller campus, make sure you've done the research so you know, you have a sense of what, like, campus life is like. How many students are on campus? How big are the facilities? What are the student services like? You know, everything, you can get all this information online, so just make sure you do as much research, talk to your IDP counselor, really get a sense of what life is like there, so that you're not so surprised when you arrive. Or it's not the right match. You will have done your research, you'll know. There's always going to be some surprises, but hopefully they're good ones when you get there.
Yeah, and the right match is, I think, the key word, because a lot of times students from India apply to a large institution, but there they feel lost. So not all students, you know, they're fit for a large institution. So right match is the key. So students should check and ask themselves this question, whether they want to go for a large institution or a small institution, and then make decisions accordingly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Whether when you're from a small city, you just might not be a good fit for a really large place. Mm-hmm. So I think, and just to, you know, add on to the point, Christine, that you were mentioning about fitment, institutions also have a lot of resources on their own website, you know, virtual tour, student ambassadors who you could speak with, IDP counselors who can connect you to a lot of people. So I think researching and fitment is going to lead to your satisfaction when when you're on the campus.
And even for smaller cities, smaller institutions, sometimes things are more affordable. Housing's more affordable.
True.
Transportation, food, there's more jobs. It may or may not be true, but often it is the case.
Yeah.
Smaller classes too, and smaller institutions can have that sort of, you might get more attention from your professor, your teachers, a bit more one-on-one support than you might otherwise get if you're in this huge city in a huge institution. So I think those are things to keep in mind.
Yeah, I completely agree. So students, do your research. Find out which institution, what type of institution is the best fit for you, and then apply as early as possible and send in complete applications. It will not only help our institutional partners, but it will also save you a lot of time. Otherwise, institutions will keep on waiting for the documents to get completed before they can roll out your letter. Yeah, so all great points. And once you know which type of institution is the best fit for you, please talk to our IDP counselors. They'll also help you connect to the right resources at all these individual institutions. If need be, we'll connect you to somebody in Canada who will help you understand what is the reality, and then you can take your final decision. So Luna and Christine, thank you so much for being here with us today. I think all your inputs, all your answers have added a lot of value to the students' decision-making process. So we are really, really thankful for your presence and all your inputs.
Thank you so much. It's such a pleasure to be here, and we're excited to see you all in Canada.